Now, outside we have a little bit of cold this morning, and I know that that really causes Pastor a little bit of consternation there, but I do want to give you hope, and that hope is we also have daffodils that are blooming, and they say sunny yellow days are coming, and green tree leaves and all the rest that goes with it. It's going to welcome in spring and summer, and so it'll be a good time of year for you. And we want to welcome you as well. Just like the daffodils are welcoming in spring, we want to welcome you here today. We want to welcome you to our worship of Jesus. We worship him in many different ways, whether that be from the mundane, like serving somebody else or bringing in our tithes and our offerings to his work here, or singing great songs and listening to the sermon and understanding more from his word. So we greet you and we welcome you this morning. There's a table in the back where you can leave prayer requests or other things like that, and we invite you to do that. But let's take a moment right now. If there's somebody you haven't greeted this morning, go ahead and take a little back and forth and greet one another, please.
Yeah. Edgel Sam.
Okay, hold on. I have to do something.
You have to go three times. You have to go three times.
No, wait.
All right, everybody, if you can please join with me in the reading of God's word today. We're in Psalm 145, 9 through 13. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to the children of man your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words and kind in all his works.
Song we could ever sing. hopeful prayer. When the world weighs on your shoulders, through sorrow and your despair, with everything, with every breath, praise the Lord. Let everything, let every breath, praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath, praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath, praise the Lord. Let everything, let every breath, praise the Lord. When the night is so long, you can sing a new song. When you're weak, he is strong. He can heal your wounded soul. Calm the storm inside.
Sing this last song to the Lord right now, the song Gratitude. I'm sure that all of us have, you know, great gratitude towards the Lord and what he's done for us. And, you know, not just on the cross, delivering us, you know, from eternal judgment, eternal punishment, but even more just in our day-to-day. You know, he carries us through our day. And sometimes we just, man, we just have nothing else. You know, it's funny how when things are good, you know, we see, you know, wow, you know, things good with my wife, or things good with my job, or, you know, whatever, you know. But those things, guys, quite often are short-lived, you know. But we always have God. We always have, you know, what he's done for us on that cross. But again, not just for salvation, but in the trials and the struggles and the tribulations of this life now. And so, as we sing this song, let's just be mindful of that, guys, because obviously, you know, we're going through stuff every day, as our country is changing and the world is changing, and especially in the West, you know, God is becoming pushed out more and more. Let's show our gratitude to our Lord as we worship him now. All my words fall short.
'Cause all that I have is
Jesus. We're grateful to you and all you have done, God, for us. Praise you, God. Continue to reign, God. Thank you for your spirit, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Have a seat, please. And just one quick update as we enter into our prayer time on Dale Fish. Pastor, you had something to say there.
Yes, guys. So Dale is doing well. It's actually one of our praise reports today. But we just got a call from Nina on the way to church. And Dale has an appointment tomorrow with a doctor that he's never seen. And the hope is that the doctor will get him put in a care, in a home where they would care for him and give him therapy. And so they're praying that that would happen by tomorrow or no later than Wednesday. And that he will have enough strength to do therapy twice a day while he's in that care, once in the morning for an hour and once in the evening for an hour. That's the prayer from Nina and Diane. So that way he can come home, because the sooner that happens, then the sooner he'll be able to come home. And then the other thing is that's not on the prayer request, is Nina and Diane are still dealing with respiratory infections, so if you guys can be praying for them. And Nina did want me to relay this to you. She knew we were going to speak this today here at the service. She just wanted me to say that from her and her mom and the Fish in the West family, that they love you guys. And I mean, she actually cried. She said that she knows that God brought her to this little church because he knew what they were going to be going through, to get them through this. And she says it's really evident in the way you guys have just had an outpouring of love and help and support for them. And so she just wanted me to relay that message to you guys. Just complete thanks to all of you guys. Good job, guys.
Would you bow with me, please? Lord, we thank you and praise you that Dale is getting somewhat better. And Lord, we just put all those prayer requests that Pastor Dave just talked about with their family and with him. Lord, we know that you know everything that he needs, and we look to you as his healer and his comforter. Lord, we look to you as the family's strength, and we just ask that you would give us your eyes and your ears, that we would understand what their needs are so that we could meet them during this time. Lord, we also praise you for the Women's Fellowship and the success that it was. We thank you for the 13 women who attended and the blessing it was to many or all that were there. Lord, we think of our requests. We think of all the health requests that we have, whether it be cancer patients or Nina and others who are going through other difficulties at this time. Lord, we ask that you would heal them. Lord, we just ask that you would give some of them miraculous healing even at this moment, that they would understand and understand that it's from you, that it would be a time where you ministered to them in a way that just really touched them and was something evident for their lives. Lord, we also think of this community, and Lord, we just ask that you would help us to grow in more in likeness to you. Lord, we ask that you would help others in this community do so as well. And for those who don't know you, Lord, we just ask that you would help us show them the kingdom. Show them you. Show them a reflection of our Lord Jesus. Lord, we just ask that you would help us do that as we prepare for the Easter service, that you would give us boldness in inviting people, that you would help us think of people that we could be having come here so that they could hear the story of how you redeemed your people from our rebellion. Lord, we thank you and praise you for all the opportunities you've given us. Lord, we just ask that you would help us to be faithful, that you would give us strength in accomplishing your mission, and that you would help us to love you more and more each day. We love you. We thank you. And we look to you as our Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good. Yeah. Good morning, everybody. Thank you guys. That's really loud. thank you guys for coming to Timberland Fellowship today. You know, as Brother Tim alluded, I, this morning, I woke up and I was like excited and getting ready to come to church and everything. And I look out the window, and this is after prayer and everything. And I'm like, yes, Lord, let's go. And it's like snowing a little bit, you know, in the valley where we live. So I was like, Lord, you're not helping me here, you know, be encouraged seeing this, you know. And so thankfully I went and I did a quick look up on the weather report, and I was assured that the temperature was going to warm up and that this stuff was going to go away. And praise God it did. So anyway, here we are, several months now into Acts. And, we've just been going through it. It's been awesome. So much growth. I've talked to so many of you, just how much you've grown. And matter of fact, even Nina, we were talking to her last week, and she was talking about just how much she knows that she's grown in her walk, her trust in the Lord, her being led by the Holy Spirit. And I can't help but just to praise God for that, you know, because that is so affirming. You know, we could come together all we want, and, you know, teaching can happen and stuff, you know, but if it doesn't, yield results, right? If it doesn't yield transformation in our lives as disciples of Christ, salt and light in the earth, those that are the bringers of the gospel to the lost world, it means nothing, guys. It's just information, guys. And so I've been so blessed by just going through this. And definitely I've witnessed myself, as I'm aware of my own growth, but I've witnessed myself growth in all of you. And so praise God, praise only God for that. As you guys know, last week we were talking about the kingdom of God. Paul was at the synagogue in Ephesus, and for the first time since Paul, at least the documented history in the Bible of Paul's ministries, for the first time when he goes to the Jewish synagogue, which was very characteristic of him, which was essentially his strategy, first to the Jew and then to the Gentile. We hear him speak, or we hear Luke write that he was reasoning and persuading with the Jews in the synagogue about the kingdom of God. And so I wanted to speak to that. I started that last week. And, I'll just say this, guys, is that I don't want to be part of any kingdom that Jesus is not the king of. That's just the bottom line. And so last week we spoke to who the king of this kingdom of God that Paul was reasoning and persuading the Jews with in the synagogue. And that king is Jesus Christ. There's no other king. There will be no other king. There is no other way. There's no other provision for the kingdom of God as far as that throne, but Jesus Christ himself, fully God and fully man. And so we spoke to that, and I kind of showed you through the word in a very quick way, but as best I could with the time we had, of how throughout history in the Bible, it was navigating us to Jesus. And again, so these are things that Paul would have spoke to when he was talking with the Jews in the synagogue at this time. As a matter of fact, he did this very thing back in Acts chapter 13. He gave a big old history lesson about the Israelites, about God's chosen people, and showed them how it pointed all the way back to Jesus Christ. And so anyway, the point is that we saw last week, from the beginning to the end of the Bible, how God's chosen king for his kingdom would come through Judah, and that king is none other than Jesus Christ. Thank you, God. Now, today we're going to continue speaking on the kingdom of God, and I specifically want to speak to the universal kingdom of God and the future kingdom of God here on earth. And we're going to go ahead and go through that. I want to go ahead and read just Acts 19. I'm just going to read verse 8 to just get us back to that point. Again, Paul in the synagogue of Ephesus, just as our kind of reference point, if you will. And then I'll pray one more time, and we will go through the text. Acts 19, verse 8. And Paul entered the synagogue, and for 3 months spoke boldly, reasoning and persuading them about the kingdom of God. So let's go ahead and say a quick prayer again, guys, and ask God just to lead our hearts in through his word and his truth, God. Guys, Heavenly Father, we thank you so much again for today and all you brought here now. We just pray, Father, whether they're here in the building or they're online or they're listening later on a recording, Father, that you would just speak into their lives now by your Holy Spirit, God. We pray your Holy Spirit would speak through me now. And that you would be glorified in all that is taught today, Father, that it would indeed be your truth. We love you. We praise you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your Son and your Spirit, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. So, as I spoke to a moment ago, when Paul went into the synagogues of the Jews throughout his ministries, and remember, we're now in his third missionary journey, he often would, Luke writes things like, you know, he'd go into the synagogue to proclaim Jesus, or he'd go into the synagogue to proclaim the word of God, or he'd go into the synagogue to proclaim forgiveness of sins through Jesus. And that went on from the very beginning. Acts chapter 9, where he was knocked down on the road to Damascus, and then he came to the Lord and believed in the Lord. Later on in that chapter, that's the very thing that he does, is he goes to the synagogues and he proclaims Jesus as the Christ. And then from Acts 17 to where we are now in Acts 19, it seemed like Luke would just say things like, well, he reasoned with them from the scriptures. And then even he just cut it short and said he reasoned with them. At this point, I think Luke knows that we now get the idea of what Paul is doing when he goes to the synagogues. But then we get here to Acts 19 and he says something different. And he says that he reasoned and persuaded them about the kingdom of God. And so this is the first time that you see Luke writing this regarding Paul's ministries, specifically when he goes into the Jewish synagogues. So this is why we're talking about the kingdom of God today. And so last week I gave you a quick definition. You know, if you were to look up that word, and I want to give it to you again, or not word, but that term, or the word kingdom rather, you would find that the definition of a kingdom is a country, a state, a territory ruled by a king or a queen, a realm under the control of a person. And we came to the conclusion, because Jesus is our king and he is our savior as well, in other words, he's our Lord, our king, and our savior, we came to the conclusion, really it's a logical conclusion, that really a king, that's what a king is supposed to do for his subjects, for his people. He's to protect and provide. In other words, he is to save all the people of his kingdom. That was the primary job of the king. Again, Jesus indeed is our risen king. And so regarding just a kingdom in regards to how it functions, there are three things that is required for a kingdom that functions. First of all, it requires a ruler with the right to rule. That's Jesus, okay? Secondly, it requires a realm to rule. That is a space, borders, you know, a domain, if you will, with people in it to rule. That's the second thing. And then the third thing, it requires that a ruler actually exercises his rightful rulership. If those three things exist, that indeed, by definition, biblically speaking, is a kingdom, and it is a functional kingdom. It is a functioning kingdom, rather. And so today, regarding the kingdom of God, again, like I said, I want to first speak to how the kingdom of God is universal. And we understand this, guys, from the very beginning at creation in Genesis chapter 1. We understand that God is creator of all things. We understand, therefore, right? Because God didn't like come into existence when the universe came into existence. God is. God presented himself to Moses as the great I am. I am, you know, and he just is, you know. And so because of God and who he is eternally, God's kingdom, even before creation, had no beginning and it has no end. It is a universal kingdom. Psalm 90 verse 2 says this, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Psalm 93 verse 2 says this, your throne is established from old, you are from everlasting. Indeed, God is eternal. His universal kingdom is eternal. Psalm 145:13 says, your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. And so I want you guys to see this, guys, because God's universal kingdom did not end when man fell in the garden. Okay? Man in the garden before the fall was part of that kingdom. All mankind, all creation was part of that kingdom. As a matter of fact, Paul writes to the fact that creation groans, waiting to be reclaimed and restored and reconciled to God. And Jesus made that possible, guys. But again, what I want you to think of is not God's kingdom here on the earth right now. I want you to think of God's kingdom universally. Okay, guys? Because that indeed was a kingdom, because again, he was the ruler. He had a domain that he ruled in, and he rightfully ruled, okay? I want you to see that aspect of it, guys, because that still exists today. God's universal rule still exists today over the entire universe. Nothing happens on earth that he doesn't first allow. Lamentation 3:37 speaks to this, Ecclesiastes 9:1, Isaiah 46:10, and Proverbs 21:30. God is on his throne. God is king. Now, God's universal kingdom literally is God sovereignly ruling over all his creation from, again, the throne of his kingdom, of his universal kingdom. I want you to see this. God is sovereign, but that doesn't mean, right, that everything that God wants to happen in a micro perspective happens. We know this because the word teaches us, right, that God wills that all men be saved. The word teaches us that God is not slow in his keeping his promise, but that he wills that no one would perish, but all would come into repentance and not perish. You guys know what I'm saying? And yet we also know from Jesus' own words that few travel the narrow gate, although God wills it. Few travel the narrow gate. So I want to speak quickly to the sovereignty of God in his universal kingdom. Again, God very graciously, sovereignly decreed that mankind should have free will. We understand this from the very beginning in the garden. Genesis chapter 2, verse 17 says this, you shall not eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, or you shall surely die. God didn't say, I'm not going to let you eat from the tree. God didn't say, I'm going to stop you from eating from the tree. God said, if you choose to eat from that tree, right, and I'm paraphrasing him, of course, because it happened. You guys understand? If you choose to eat from that tree, the day you do, you will surely die. He gave them free will. He gave them a choice. I love what it says in Deuteronomy 30, 19 through 20. God's direct word says, I set before you life and death, blessing and curse. You choose. Deuteronomy 11, 26 through 28 speaks to the same thing. Joshua 24, 15 says this, choose this day whom you will serve. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. So you guys can see that there is a choice here, that God, from his sovereign will, has decreed that we have free will, that we have liberty to exercise free will. And this is why you see what you see, right? Along with the fact that this is a broken world because of the fall. But this is why you see so much stuff in the world today that does not line up with the will of God. You guys know what I'm saying? And thankfully, God, on his universal kingdom's throne, right, can use even those bad things for good, and he does. He can use even those things to glorify his name. John chapter 1, verses 12 to 13 says this, all who did receive him, he gave the right to become God's children. There's a choice here, guys. All who did receive him, all who chose to receive him, he gave the right to become God's children. John 3:16 speaks to this very thing, and we know that. I'm not going to recite that. We know what that is. But here's the thing, guys, is even though God is sovereign, I'm telling you this because I want you to understand that we know, because we see it in the world today, we know that evil can and does still happen in this broken world, right? But like I just said, God still can and does use it for good for those who love him, Romans 8:28, you know. This is not God's preferred way, but because of the free will aspect, this is what is. And God, man, he still makes what he ultimately wants, his absolute will happen. Now, I will say this, guys, and I don't want to speak to this for a second, but some actually believe that in a microcosmic kind of perspective, that God determines every single minute thing, you know, that happens in the world. Like, for instance, like I just picked up this flask because God determined that before the foundations of the earth. Some people believe that, you know. I don't know how that lines up with free will. I don't share that assessment. Now, wherever you are with that, that's between you and God, but I don't believe that God determines every single minute thing that way, okay? And the reason why I don't believe it, because I'm not going to blame God when a rape happens or when a murder happens or when a child gets cancer. I'm not going to do that, right? I will, however, look to God and say, wow, God, when I see a miracle happen, something that cannot be explained, whether it's by medical science or just science in general, when it can't be explained, I know that's God. But I don't believe that God determines every single thing. In other words, I don't believe that God being sovereign, and indeed he is sovereign on his universal kingdom's throne, I don't believe that means that he determines every single thing. Like when my back itches and I have to scratch it, I don't believe that he determined that. I believe that that happens. But again, like I said, guys, I also believe that we can't override God's absolute will. God's plan will prevail. What God wants will happen. We can make free choices outside of that, but ultimately it'll be to our demise if we don't do what he's telling us to do. And specifically when it comes to the cross, again, God wills that all be saved. So I guess this begs the next question. If God's kingdom is universal, if God is on his universal throne, right, then why are there two kingdoms today, right? Why do we have the kingdom of God in our hearts today, and why do we have Satan's kingdom? Well, I want to go back to the beginning for that again. God's kingdom on earth. God, from his grace and his love, decided to create what he created here in the universe. And part of that creation was mankind. It started in the garden with Adam and Eve. And at that time, like I alluded to a moment ago, there was only one kingdom because he ruled it all. This is pre-fall, right? And I want to read to you Genesis 1:26 and 28. Because God indeed gave mankind rule and dominion over all creation. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 28 says this. Then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. You hear this, guys? Let them have dominion. Let them have rule, right, over everything on the earth. Verse 28. And God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves on the earth. Do you see this, guys? Man was given authority over all of creation. That lasted not very long. Two chapters, right? And I don't know what that means time frame wise, but that lasted two chapters, and then, you know, we tripped, and then, so here we go. Adam and Eve, they lost that rule. They lost that dominion. They lost, essentially, the rule of the kingdom, God's kingdom on earth, right, that he established on earth at that time, to Satan in the garden. Now we understand that Satan has rule over this world. John 12:31 says this, now is the judgment of this world. Now will the ruler of this world be cast out. The ruler of this world is Satan, guys. Ephesians 2:2 says, in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. Do you see this? The enemy is a prince. He's a prince of a kingdom, right? His dark kingdom on earth. 2 Corinthians 4:4 says this, in their case, the God, that's little g God, of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. There you go again, the God of this world. And finally, Revelation 2:13 says this, I know where you dwell, where Satan's throne is, yet you hold fast my name, and you did not deny my faith, even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was killed among you, where Satan dwells. Guys, indeed, Satan has rule over this world right now. And so when Adam and Eve, when they did what they did and they fell, they literally became subject to Satan. I want to read this to you guys. Romans 6:16 says this. You are slaves of the one whom you obey. Mankind literally became slaves or subjects to Satan because of the fall. In other words, they obeyed Satan, his word, over God's word. And therefore they submitted to Satan, right? And because of that, God had given mankind rule over the world, but because now Satan rules them, do you see what happens? Now Satan has usurped that authority on the planet. Jesus actually says this in John 8:44 as he's speaking to God's chosen people, the Israelites, the Jews. He says, "You are of your father the devil." Do you guys see it? Another really kind of cool thing, to speak to this is found in Luke 4:5-6. It says this, and the devil took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time and said to him, to you I will give all this authority and their glory, for it has been delivered to me and I give it to whom I will. So literally when Satan was tempting Jesus with all the kingdoms of the earth, he wasn't just like tricking him in that he wouldn't give him the kingdoms, like he had authority to do it because all the kingdoms of the earth rage, as the word says, against the kingdom of God. He literally was giving Jesus a genuine offer here, and praise God that Jesus rejected it, right, and overcame that through the word of God. But again, Satan literally offered Jesus all authority over all the kingdoms of the world, for he ruled them. So why then would God allow two earthly kingdoms? Why would God do that? Well, namely because of us, guys. Namely because of the elect. Those who would believe on his son to become part of his kingdom. Now, I speak to this often, guys, and this always blows me away when I think about it, that in that moment that we fell, God could have easily and justly and rightfully judged all creation right then and there. He had every right to do it. But instead, in his love, he gave us mercy and grace. And so the reason why there's two earthly kingdoms is because his elect, those who would have faith in Christ. Again, I spoke to these verses earlier, 2 Peter 3:9, how God is not slow to keep his promise, but he waits and he wills that no one would perish. 1 Timothy 2:4, that God wills that all mankind be saved. Titus 2:11 also speaks to this. So I want you to see this, guys, because God sovereignly rules even over a dark and broken world today in his universal kingdom. And obviously, Satan's kingdom indeed is dark. But I want you to see this because both kingdoms are spiritual. And where a Christian is, the kingdom is there because the Christian is there. We call Satan's kingdom the dark kingdom, the evil kingdom. There's actually a word that many a commentator used to describe the kingdom of God here on earth, and that is God's mediatorial kingdom, which literally just means a mediator, someone who mediates between God and man. We understand the mediator, right? There's one mediator between man and God, and that is Jesus the Christ. We understand that to be the truth. But again, I want you to see that where Christians are, is where God reigns. Do you see it, guys? In our hearts. There is somebody who rightfully can rule. There is a domain where he can rule, a space where he can rule, right? And he exercises rule when we humble ourselves to his leading, in other words, to his Holy Spirit, guys. And that's all part of the mediatorial kingdom, you know? Now, there were, or there is really two phases, or there was two phases of God's mediatorial kingdom. We understand the first part of that phase was the theocratic kingdom. That was the kingdom that where God came to Moses and said, hey, deliver my people, right? And Moses went out and, you know, and delivered the people from Egypt through God's power, and God had his people there. And we understand this because we spoke to this last week. Exodus 19, God says that you are a peculiar treasure to me, speaking to the people through Moses at Mount Sinai. You are a peculiar treasure to me. You are a kingdom of priests. You are a nation set apart unto me. Obviously, the Israelites chipped on that one, right? And so now we have what is called the Messianic kingdom. That's the kingdom where Jesus is on the throne of your heart, guys. And that kingdom is just ruled by Jesus. And keep in mind, guys, that Jesus didn't just try to do like Satan and usurp the power. Jesus was specifically chosen by God himself to be the Messiah, to be the Lord, to be the Savior. Again, the theocratic kingdom of the mediatorial kingdom was the old covenant. The messianic kingdom of the mediatorial kingdom is the new covenant, guys. But these two kingdoms that I've been speaking to, the dark kingdom of Satan and the mediatorial kingdom of God here on earth, okay, they are part of the universe and still under God's sovereign rule. Now, even though Adam and Eve fell, God promised to restore a righteous human ruler, again, as I just said, of his choice as king over his kingdom. We know this from Genesis 3, chapter 15. I'm going to go ahead and read that to you guys. And it says this. Speaking to the woman, when God was laying down his judgment on Adam, on Eve, and on the serpent, speaking to Eve, he says this, I will put enmity between you and the woman, or rather to Satan, excuse me, and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. So that was when God was saying, I choose my Messiah. I choose who's going to be king over my kingdom here on earth. And that is none other again than Jesus. Literally what God was saying is that a son through the woman was coming from that human woman, and he would crush the serpent's head and destroy the work of him. 1 John 3:8 says this, whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil, for the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. So here's what happens in a nutshell, guys, is the first Adam lost, right, dominion over the earth in the garden, and the last Adam shall restore it. He will reclaim it. And that's exactly what Jesus has come to do. Again, last week I referenced, again, just how the Old Testament scriptures pointed us to Jesus, and we also know Matthew chapter 1, verses 1 through 16, how it shows us the lineage of Jesus from the very beginning as God's chosen king, as God's anointed one, his chosen one. You guys understand that Messiah, that's what that word means. A lot of time we call it Savior, and it does indirectly mean Savior, but it means chosen one. It means anointed one, God's chosen one. And we spoke to the fact that, again, Jesus is that king. Jesus is the king that God chose, again, to be king over his kingdom in the garden after the fall. I want to give you guys a couple of pictures here. That when Jesus first came, that was really the beginning of his kingdom starting, right? Jesus the King was then coronated as the King of God when he ascended into heaven, guys. And then Jesus the King will one day return a second time and consummate the kingdom of God, which again, which is a now in his church, in our hearts, where we are, but one day will be a future kingdom on earth. And so the kingdom of God on earth is future. Right now, it's spiritual in each of us, the Christian guys, okay? But one day, the kingdom of God is going to be a spiritual and a physical kingdom. One day, Christ, God's chosen king, fully man and fully God, will literally rule on earth. Jesus says things like this when he was here in his, during his ministry. He says, "Thy kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Matthew 6:10. He says, this is how you ought to pray. He's speaking to the church. Jesus says this, "Not everyone will enter the kingdom. Many will say to me on that day." We know the rest of that, Matthew 7:21 through 23. And then regarding Jesus, it says that on that day, when he returns that second time, his feet shall stand on the Mount of Olives, Zechariah 14:4. Now, I want you guys to see this, because that mediatorial kingdom will be given back to God under his universal rule one day. Revelation 11:15 says this, "Then the seventh angel blew his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven, saying, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever." Now, some of your translations, specifically the King James and the New King James version, will put that word kingdom there, where it says the world has become the kingdom of our Lord, or the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord. That word, the kingdom, is plural in the King James and the New King James version. And really, that just speaks to the rule over all the kingdoms on the earth that Satan has right now over those kingdoms. And he has had from the very beginning, guys. But all your modern translations, like the ESV where I'm reading from, NIV, New American Standard, etc., they all have this as plural, guys. And so, they're both right, I guess, is what I'm trying to say. I just didn't want you to be alarmed by that. But here's the thing, guys, is if you notice in this verse, it says that the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. Okay? So Lord written here with Christ speaks of God's sovereign rule. Do you see this? His sovereign rule. The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. Do you guys see that? So here's my point, is that once the mediatorial kingdom is cleansed by God's angels, Matthew 13:38-43, right, when Jesus comes back. Let me read that to you, actually, guys. This is a parable that Jesus had given. And Jesus actually gave the definition or what that parable meant. I'll read that, Matthew 13:38-43. It says this, "The field is the world, and the good seed is the sons of the kingdom. The weeds are the sons of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are gathered and burned with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all lawbreakers, and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Who has ears, let him hear." So guys, what's going to happen, guys, is what we lost, how there was this universal kingdom, right, of God before the fall, right? And then all of a sudden there was these two kingdoms striving for souls, right? What we lost will be restored back to God. Literally, that mediatorial kingdom will become fused to God's eternal universal kingdom forever. And again, just so you know, kingdom here refers to dominion and to reign. I can't speak to that enough, guys. God will have dominion and reign again. Completely, all that he wants, all of his will be in that kingdom, unlike it is going on the earth today. Again, that which was lost by the first Adam will be restored by the last Adam. Let me read you 1 Corinthians 15:28. It says this, "When all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to him who put all things in subjection under him, that God may be all in all. Again, when the future kingdom is consummated on the earth, making the mediatorial kingdom part of God's universal rule, there will no longer be a need for this strife, this battle that we have between the two kingdoms, because that second kingdom will be gone, and God will rule like he always wanted to, like he always did. He will dwell with his people as ruler, and we're told that in Revelation chapter 21, verse 3. It says this, "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God." So really what I want to speak to today, guys, because that speaks of the future kingdom. That speaks of how the universal kingdom of God, which is now, right, he rules the whole universe. When Jesus restores it all, right, and the final enemy, death itself, is conquered, the kingdom, the mediatorial kingdom, will be fused to God's universal kingdom one day, guys. That is the future of the earthly kingdom of Jesus Christ, guys. But what I really want you to see today, though, as I was just saying, guys, is that we must understand this truth, guys. We must understand the difference between God's universal kingdom and the mediatorial kingdoms, or the mediatorial kingdom, excuse me. Again, God's universal kingdom is eternal, and one day, all that come to Jesus, all that go, that put their faith in Jesus, they will be made part of that in the kingdom, the mediatorial kingdom, will be made part of the universal kingdom of God. Again, God indeed is the eternal sovereign king of the universe. So again, when that happens, his kingdom, his universal kingdom, will include that. So I just want to read a couple of verses to you, but what I do want to say, guys, is quite often you guys, I don't know about you, but me personally, when I'm going through hard times especially, I wish I recognized this more. I will say things like, yeah, it's hard. Yeah, I'm hurt. Yeah, you know, it's really not a good time, or there's a tragedy or something, but God is still on the throne. You know, God is still in control. God can still redeem this. God can still restore this. God can still make good on this. This is exactly what Abraham thought to himself when God asked him to take his son up on a mountain, right, and sacrifice him. In Hebrews 11, it tells us that Abraham believed that God could resurrect him. You see what I'm saying, guys? But my point is this, is that we need to understand that, look, if we're talking about God's universal kingdom as opposed to what's happening on earth now, this is why we can say that. You guys see this in Job chapter 1. Let me go ahead and read that to you guys. I think that's really a good picture of what I'm speaking to. Because again, Satan is the ruler of this world, the king of this world, if you will, the god of this world. But he still very is much subject to God. Let me read to you verses 6 through 12 in Job chapter 1. "Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them." Now, guys, just keep in mind that the word Lord there, it means sovereign. It means ruler. And so Satan, who we just learned from the scripture itself, is the god of this world, is the prince of this of the air, right? He comes to the Lord. "And the Lord said to Satan, 'From where have you come?' Satan answered the Lord and said, 'From going to and fro on the earth and walking from up and down on it.'" Now, for your translations, if you guys see the word Lord there in caps, you can know that it's talking about God. It's talking about the sovereign. It's talking about Yahweh. Verse 8, "And the Lord said to Satan, 'Have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil?' Then Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for no reason? Have you not put a hedge around him and his house and all that he has on every side? You guys see this? Like, Satan couldn't just go mess with Job because he's still subject, even though he's king of the kingdom, the dark kingdom on earth, he's still subject to God on his universal throne. Do you guys see this? He can't just go do what he wants to do. He says, continuing there in verse 10, you have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will curse you to your face. And then listen to this, guys. This is God's command to Satan. And the Lord said to Satan, behold, all that he has is in your hand. Only against him do not stretch out your hand. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. That is a picture of the universal throne of God. Satan, yes, he's the king of the world. He's the God of the world. He's the prince of the air. But he still very much is subject to the universal authority, the sovereignty of God. And we see that picture right there, guys. And that's what I want you to differentiate between the universal kingdom of God and the mediatorial kingdom of God, which is on the earth. And one day will be future, and in the future will be fully consummated when Jesus returns. When you do what you do, when you walk around and you tell people about Jesus, you literally are waging war against the kingdom of darkness. That's what you're doing. But it's all so that all who would believe in Jesus Christ, all who, as Jesus says seven different times in the book of Revelation, all who would overcome, even unto death, those people, that they could be restored back to that universal rule of God. Because let's just be honest, guys. You know what I'm saying, because although it is in your heart to follow the Lord and to do his will, you and I both know that you don't always do his will. Quite often you fall. Sometimes, of course, it's unknowingly, but I would submit that probably sometimes you do it knowingly. And yet God still loves you. God still died for you. God still hopes for you. And so I want you to see that, guys. When we say things like God is still on the throne, God is still in control, he is in control. This is why Satan came to him regarding Job. He didn't just go mess with Job. Believe you me, Job would have been the first guy that Satan went to if he had just free reign to do what he wanted to in God's universe. But he didn't. God's sovereign rule from his universal kingdom is the final word. And everything that happens under the sun, God approves it. God allows it. Nothing happens that surprises God. Nothing happens that God doesn't say, yes, you can, or no, you can't. Nothing, guys. And that comes from the universal throne of God, the eternal kingdom of God. And that's what we're speaking about today. So, I want you to understand this, because it is really hard in our world right now, guys. I've heard some stories that I can't even believe some of the things that I'm hearing that are going on right now in the world. And sometimes, guys, all we can say is, hey, that really stinks what just happened, but God is on the throne. God is in control. God is going to restore and reclaim all things to himself, who indeed, those who want to, those who want it. Regardless of all the discouragement that's going on in the world, guys, whether it's the economy, and I keep hearing there's going to be a recession, or the hatred of God and the hatred of Christians and the hatred of the truth of God, or the twisting of God's word, whatever it is, guys, you know, we hear what's going on in the schools, we see what's going on in the workplace, you know, and at work, you know, I think I've talked to this before. There used to be a time when you were in a meeting and you had to conduct yourself in a very respectful way. You couldn't speak of things that were kind of, you know, not kosher, so to speak. You certainly couldn't use cuss words. But it's a normal thing in the workplace today, and specifically in meetings, and with meetings with people that are like high up there, you know? So we see this continuous, you know, corrosion of society, and further getting away from God and the kingdom of the people of God through Jesus. It's starting to narrow down. You know, people I hear about all the time. Well, he walked away from the Lord. And it can be a very discouraging thing, guys, these days that we're living in, these days of sin and corruption and immorality, even deception, guys, where we're told that good is bad and bad is good. But I want to encourage you today, guys, that although we are fighting a battle, we are fighting a battle for souls right now. Each of us, as Paul puts it, as soldiers of Christ, soldiers in Christ, fighting that battle, being light, calling people to the kingdom of God. God is still on the throne of his eternal universal kingdom. And one day, when Jesus returns, there's going to be a reckoning. One day when Jesus returns, he will have complete rule over the entire earth. I want to read to you 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, 1 through 11. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers, you have no need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you are not in darkness, brothers, for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light, children of the day. We are not of the night or of the darkness. So then let us not sleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build one another up, just as you are doing. And I just want to encourage you guys with that word today. It's a very discouraging world that we live in today. Even here in the little corner of Napa, you know, some of the things, that as I've been here for 17 years in July, it'll be, and even in that short amount of time, I've watched this community transform, you know, further and further away from Christ, further and further away from God. When I first went, when we first got here, we went to numerous churches trying to find a church to go to, and every church I went to was packed, you know. I go to churches now, or I have gone to churches in the last few years, and it's dead, you know, in our community. And I'm not bashing anybody. I'm just saying, guys, that can be discouraging. But take heart. Jesus is your king. And God is still on his universal throne. Know again that he is on that throne, that he's still in control, and the enemy can't just come on you and mess with you. Look to God. Look to God in these hard times. Let that be your encouragement. Let that be your joy. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for today and for your word, God, and thank you, God, for the truth that no matter what happens on this earth, God, although Satan is running around and roaming around like a lion on the prowl, as your word says, you're still on the throne. You still are in control. Satan can't just come and mess with us, God, without you okaying it first and you putting limitations and borders on what he is allowed to do, as he himself, although a king of the earth, is still under your authority, God, still under your eternal kingdom's throne. I just pray, God, that would be real in all of our hearts and all of our minds, that we wouldn't just, you know that in a in an intellectual sense, God, but that we would own that, God, in faith, that we would live that out, that we would walk that out, that even when we go through hard times, God, even when we go through struggles, God, that we would know, and that would be our encouragement, our joy, and our peace, that you are on the throne, that you are on an everlasting throne, and that you are our cover. Again, Lord, I just want to pray for our church. As you know, we're such a small church, but we see just from, you know, the few families we do have, God, of how we are being attacked. Everything from struggles with health to struggles with just everyday life, we see these things, God. And yet you, being on the throne, continue to lift us up, continue to provide and cover us, and we thank you so much for your grace. Father, we look to you, we love you, and we praise you, and we thank you that we can because of Jesus on a cross, Jesus our King and our Savior. Also want to lift up those, God, who heard your word today that don't know you, God, that they would indeed turn to you now through Jesus, that they would repent their sin, that they would place their faith and their trust in Jesus as Lord and Savior of their lives, God. That they would become part of your kingdom. Again, Father, we love you, we praise you, we thank you for that great act of mercy, saving us, choosing to save us through your chosen Messiah, Jesus, instead of judging us. Please bless the rest of this service today to your praise. We do thank you for Jesus, our King and Savior, and we do thank you for your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
One of the things about the testimony that we have as believers in Jesus Christ is that we can go to other people in our witness and we can tell them, look, I was lost. I was in the muck. I was in the mire. I was beyond recognition. I was in trouble and God delivered me. We can go to them and tell them that. We've seen numerous times, or we see numerous times in the Word of God healing somebody or casting out demons, restoring this and redeeming that. And our Redeemer, Christ, he's in the business of redemption. He's in the business of reconciliation. So as we sing this song, guys, do it again. Just know, guys, that we have a God that not only can he do it again, he will. He wants to do it again. And I know that the enemy speaks against you sometimes. It's hard. You can't even hardly hear the voice of the Lord. But remember what he has done. Remember how much he loves you. So much that he gave his only son. Remember how much he hopes for you. And he wants for you. Remember that he will do it again. He'll do it in your life, and he'll do it in the lives of those people around you, maybe your family, your friends, your neighbors, who don't know him yet. He will do it. Press in now and worship. Worship our King Jesus.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness, I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still in. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again.
Come on, church.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet. I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe. I see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way. And I believe. I see you do it again. I've seen you move. You move the mountains. And I believe. I see you do it again. I see you do it again. Yeah. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Confidence, you never.
Heavenly Father, we praise you again and just thank you for today. Thank you for your word and for this service and you know, all that we're here today, Father. And mostly, Father, you, your presence, your spirit, Father, we thank you so much, God. And we just give you praise and glory for it. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Why you ever chose me has always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line with all the other not quite, with all the never get it right. But it turns out they're the ones you were looking for all this time. 'Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. And ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing, living for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus, living for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus. Moses had stage fright, David brought a rock to a sword fight. You picked 12 outsiders nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. But the moral of the story is everybody's got a purpose. So when I hear that devil start talking to me saying, who do you think you are? I say, I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody I'm all about somebody. Save my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
Another blood-bought, faithful member of the family. And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
'Cause I'm just a nobody
trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
Let's close out in prayer one more time. Father, we thank you for today and for this service. Thank you again, Lord. We just ask as we leave now that we would go out in peace and we go into that mission field and be light and salt in the earth, God. Again, use us this week to minister to people, Father. Good news of Jesus, the good news of your kingdom, God. We love you. We praise you, God. Thank you for your Son and your Spirit, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you guys. Have a great week.